One day, when Tarang was 7, his father came home from Malig with a Carabao bokal, which belonged to their neighbor Longinus, who lived in the clearing across the river. The Carabao pulled a sled which had a lone basket for its load. "Haraw!" his father said, pulling bokal to stop. Tarang ran to catch the lead rope that his had tossed over him. Bokal flared its nostrils and gave him a good look with its big water eyes, as if to say, "Well, anak, here we are. Have you been good?" He had been playing alone in the yard in the long slack of afternoon, and had been good, except that once Nanay had said why didn't he go to the hut and do his playing there, so that at the same time he could look after his little sister, Chris, just learning to crawl. But that was because Nanay had wanted to go there in the shade and pound rats, when what she ought to have done was wait for Tatay to help her, or wait for him to grow up, even. So what he had done was keep silent when she called. Then afterward, she was spanking Chris for not taking an afternoon nap. And Tara heard her calling to him, "You'll see when your Tatay comes." And so he walked to the river bank and gathered some guavas and ate the ripe ones as fast as he got them. And now he was belching, his breath smelling guava. Perhaps his hair, too, smelled of guava.
For why should Boca flare his nostrils that way?
With Chris astride her hip, Nanay came down at the hut saying, "You might give that hard-headed son of yours a thrashing for staying out in the sunshine all afternoon." But Tarang only laughed. "Really?" he said, and then asked, "But you would know what I've brought here." "What is this time?" Nanay asked. Tarang looked at the basket on the sled. "If you must know, it's a pig," Tatay said. He had unhitched the sled and was leading the Carabao away. "Now, don't you try touching it," his mother warned Tarang, "so the boy will have something to look after." Tatay was saying from under the tree across the yard, where he had gathered the Carabao. From down the sled, Tarang pulled the basket, and indeed, 2 black feet presently thrust out of it. The corner of the basket had a big hole, and now there sprang forth another foot. Tatay cut the basket with his bolo, and the pig struggled out. "It's for you to look after," told the boy. Nanay was standing there beside him, and having swung Chris over to other hip, began scratching the belly of the pig with her big toe. "Do this quite often, and it will become tame," she said. "Tatay, now if you hold Chris a while," then she took the bolo and crossing the yard. She went past the hinagdong tree where Bokal was and into the underbrush. She returned with 6 freshly ripe papayas. She wanted then and there to cut them up and feed the pig with them. But Tatay said, "Here, you hold Chris yourself. Get back the bolo from Nanay. Slip it into its sheath and hurry down to the path to the Kaingin." Tara could see the tall dead trees of the clearing beyond the hinagdong tree and the second growth. The afternoon sun made the barks of the tree glisten like the bolo blade itself. He thought his father would be away very long, but Tatay was back soon with a length of tree trunk, which had not been completely burned that day they set fire to that clearing. The fire had devoured only the hull of the trunk, so that what Tatay had brought was really a truth that the Kaingin had made. Now Tatay cut the ends neatly and flattened one-sided so that the truth would sit firm on the ground. They all sat there watching the pigs eating off the truth. In a short while, its snout was black from rubbing against the burned bottom and sides. "Where did this pig come from?" "You have not said a word," Nanay said.
"Well, there was I in the barrio, nom do I see but Paula, when all the time I meant not to get even a shot of her." Tarang stared at both of them, not knowing what they were talking about. Chris sat on Nana's arm, watching the pig also, and making little bubbling sounds with her mouth. "We shall pay everything we owe them next harvest," Nanay said. "Well, there I was, and she saw me," Tatay went on. "She asked could I go to her house and have my noon meal there. So I went and ate in the kitchen. Then she asked could I fetch some water and fill the jars. And could I split some firewood. And could I go out there in the corner of the yard and have a look at her pigs. She had 3 of them, one a boar," Tatay went on.
And if I wasn't really afraid that I'd be told to fix the fence or the pen, I'm a liar at this very moment. For a gun or 5 chupas of salt, maybe. Why not? Nanay asked. I guess right, she said. Fix it for the ganda of salt that you got from the store last time. Well, there you are. That's the trouble. There I was, but she said. For your little boy to look after, if you like. Yes, but I take one soul with you. And I said, for my boy? Because, believe me, I was so proud and happy. Paula remembered her son, she said. If we can fatten it and let it have a litter, then all the better for us. So I've brought home the pig. Nanay threw more bits of fried papaya into the trough. Tarang scratched the pigs with something else in his belly. If there is a litter, you are to have, his father was saying. And then his mother said, that is good enough. Well then, feed it well enough, his father said. And you said, there was a boar in that pen? His mother asked. A big and vigorous boar, his father said. Nanny smiled and then walked over to the kitchen to start a fire in the stove. When the pig had devoured the ripe papaya, Tata got a rope and made a harness of it around the pig's shoulder. Here, better get it used to you, Tata said. So Tarang pulled the rope and dragged the pig across the yard. His father led the way through the bush to the edge of the kaingin nearest the hut. Then they tied the pig to a tree stump. Then his father cut some stakes to make the pen with.